Good morning. If you're able, please stand for the call to worship. If you're able, please stand for the call to worship, which you will see in your bulletin. This comes from Psalm 133. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion.
For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore.
Let's praise God.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
My Savior,
he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender.
Your light, let the whole world see like this.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
One more, shine your light and
shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Just the voices sing, my Savior.
My Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Forever. Church, he rose.
He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. My Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever.
Father, we thank you for this day. Indeed, you did conquer the grave. You did rise just as you said that you would. Lord, we celebrated that fact last Sunday for Easter. We celebrate that fact today. Each and every day, Lord, we can come to you boldly, to your throne of grace, knowing that you are our Savior, that you love us, that nothing can hold you back. For you are the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. You are King of kings and Lord of lords. So this day we celebrate your name, Lord. We thank you for your great love. And Lord, we come to you professing our faith, saying what we believe together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord God, we thank you that we may gather with confidence, that we may share that you are King of kings and Lord of lords. And yet, Lord, we come humbly before you. We confess, the Lord, that although we try, we are imperfect. We sin against you. So, Lord, hear us as we confess to you silently our sins. Lord Jesus, our Savior, we thank you for this gift where you invite us to come to you, to confess our need of you. And your promise is that when we confess our sins, you do forgive us. As far as the east is from the west, so far you remove our transgressions from us. And we thank you, Lord, that in you, you alone, we have forgiveness. It is in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. It is through our Lord and Savior that we do have peace with him. Let us share the peace of Christ with one another this morning. What a joy it is for us to share life together, isn't it? I want to refer you to page 6 in your bulletin and to point out a couple of very important announcements. This Sunday, April 23rd, or next Sunday, April 23rd, whenever that is, our Wednesday clubs will be putting on a musical, O Chicken of Little Faith. So you don't want to miss that. It's adorable. You will love it. There you go. So be there. You will love it. It is adorable. April the 23rd. Also, if you are new to the church and you are interested in being a member of our church, our next Inquirers class, More Grace, will begin Sunday, April the 23rd, the same Sunday, April the 23rd at 9 o'clock in room 208. That's in the Media Center, not far from here. This is a five-week class which will explore fellowship, theology, and ministries of Triangle Grace Church. This class is a requirement for membership at our church, but you're not obligated to join at the conclusion of the class. You can see a QR code there. You can scan that and see more information. It's fun because at the church, we share lives together. We get to interact in so many different ways. And I've had the privilege to walk together with some of the students from our church going through confirmation class. I'm going to tell you about that today, but today they are going to join our church. I'm going to go ahead and invite them to come forward and stand in front of the table. Annalise Kirshner. They were wondering who was going to go first. Just stand right up there. Good job. Lauren Jackson. Lisa Rader. Excuse me. Matt Canada. Glenda Blair Wilder. Connor Cole. Also today, I would like to, if you are an elder, you may please come forward and stand back behind the kids. We're going to ask for you to pray for them in a little while. And as the elders come forward, I'm going to ask our confirmation class, you get to go first. Members, speak loud and slow. Introduce yourself, tell us where you go to school, and one thing about yourself.
I'm Connor Cole. I go to Woods Charter School, and I like kayaking.
I'm Glenda Blair Wilder. I go to Voyager Academy, and I love to dance.
I'm Matt Canada. I go to Rogers Her, and I like to swim.
I'm Lisa Rader. I go to Brogdon, and I also like to swim.
I'm Lauren Jackson. I go to Woods Charter, and I play soccer.
I'm Annalise Kirshner. I go to Colberth, and I like to play volleyball.
Thank you. So over the last couple of months, we've been meeting, and Ms. Director Jessica is over here, our middle school director, and we've been going through church history and theology, all the books of the Bible, Old and New Testament, in order. How would you do on a test on these things? They all got 100 on it. But we have a good time talking. Their very first class, I'm not going to give it all away, but I tell them, no paper, no pens, and let's walk outside. And we walk outside, and I tell them just to be still. Don't we live in a culture that we're always going fast, fast, fast? So we try to have a moment where we can be still and take God up on his invitation and know that God is God. And so that's how we start our class. And throughout almost 2 months of meeting, we get to wonder about who God is and what does he mean for us in 2023 in our individual lives, and what does it mean for this group together to walk in their faith together. So it's been a blessing for us to do that together. And I'm going to ask Ms. Director Jessica to come forward, and she wants to talk with you for a moment.
Hi, so every single person that we had in our class this year just had different things to offer to the whole entire group, to me, to Pastor Jeff, to each other, and so I just wanted to take a second and share just one specific thing about each student that we have here and what they brought to us this year. And so I'll start on my side over here with Connor. It was awesome. Connor always had something to share for an answer, whether Pastor Jeff asked a question that was related to review or whether it was something brand new. Connor was always willing to share, no matter if he thought his answer was 100% correct or not. He was always willing. So thank you. Next, we have Glenda Blair. One thing, so whether I came into the room after she'd already been there, or if I was in the room and she came in next, she just always made the room so welcoming and so inviting. Her smile just blew up across the room. It was just fabulous. And so she just made it such a comfortable space, and I know that we all really appreciated that, so thank you. Next, with Matt. So Matt was very patient with our group because he came in every single time so ready to just take in all this information, and we weren't all at that same place. Sometimes we were kind of wanting to joke around and like just kind of, yeah, joke around a little bit. And Matt was very patient with us. Pastor Jeff is nodding. He gave us a lot of patience in that. And we really appreciate that, Matt, so thank you. Lisa. So I laugh because this was actually happening when we were talking about what they were going to do when they came in here today. But Liesl, you always made sure to ask like clarifying questions, especially. And if I could tell, like maybe I just saw the looks on people's faces that maybe some information just didn't quite click yet or whatever it may be, you were always willing to ask that clarifying question. And as I said, right before we came in here, she was doing that. Pastor Jeff would say something and she would like, okay, wait, so like, are we supposed to do this? So we really appreciate that. I know your classmates appreciate that too, because you were the one that was willing to do that. So thank you. Lauren, why do you look at me like that? Okay, Lauren, I mean, as everyone's laughing, Lauren always had like the subtle humor that she wanted to bring in, because I mean, I said that like people have helped make it like a comfortable space, like willing to share and just be helpful. Lauren, you always had like some subtle humor to like enter in that kind of just made us all, if we were a little bit tense or like maybe if we had like an awkward silence or something, Lauren would just like insert something and you could feel everyone just kind of take a deep breath and maybe chuckle a little bit. So we definitely appreciate that. Thank you. All right, and Annalise, for you, one thing that I really, really noticed just over the span of the couple months was, it's gonna sound like, I don't know, your note-taking. It was crazy because every time I looked, Pastor Jeff would ask a question and maybe somebody would be answering, but you were always going back to your notes so that if somebody didn't get the question right, you were right in there ready to give the right answer. And that was helpful because the rest of them were kind of like, oh, I don't really know. So thanks for always coming in clutch with the backup. We really appreciate that. So thank all of you. I'm so proud of you. So thank you for everything that you brought to the table.
Great. So Ms. Director Jessica used to stand here. She was in our youth group, and now she's our middle school director. So if you do not know her, say hello to her after the church. She'll also be up here with me praying for you if you have a prayer later. So we hope to pray for you. Pastor Chris.
Yeah, I get to ask the formal questions. And so listen carefully to what I'm about to ask. And if you agree, affirm them positively. Do you acknowledge yourself to be a sinner in the sight of God, justly deserving God's displeasure, and without hope except in God's sovereign mercy? If so, answer, I do. And do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and depend upon Christ alone for your salvation as offered in the gospel? If so, answer, I do. Do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? If so, answer, I do. Do you promise to serve Christ in the church by supporting and participating in its services to God and its ministries to others to the best of your ability? If so, answer, I do. And finally, do you submit yourselves to the government and discipline of the church and promise to further its purity and peace? If so, answer, I do. Amen. I'm going to ask the elders to come forward, lay hands on this wonderful group of young people. And Jeff, you going to pray for them?
Yes.
Thanks.
Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for your great love for us, specifically for this confirmation class. Thank you, Lord, for all the things that we've got to experience together, learning more about you and how to read your Bible, learning more about the church and how we are woven together as a body of Christ. We thank you, Lord, for your faithful love. We ask your continued blessing on this confirmation class today and into the future. We thank you, Lord, that you call the church to come together as one, to worship you, to love each other, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. We thank you, Lord, for this day. It is in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Your class of 2023 confirmation class. As the elders are greeting them, I would like to invite the shorter, smaller children to come forward, please. And we'll have a time with Pastor Chris. So children, come forward with Pastor Chris.
Right on over here, everybody. You can still join us if you want. I can just room for it. Okay. Thank you. Hi, how are you? Comes a few from the balcony. Well, Easter was last week, and boy, there sure was a lot going on. There are banners and flowers and candles and all kinds of stuff. And there was one thing we didn't really talk about in big church very much, but it happened right outside in the narthex, that area right outside the back of the church, back of the sanctuary. Did anyone notice what was in the back? Just right outside the door on Easter? I bet you did. Some of you probably even had a picture around it. Yeah.
A cross with flowers on it.
That's right. A cross with flowers on it. Would we call it the resurrection cross? Is that what's the term? That sound good? Okay. Well, from today on, it's called the resurrection cross. And so here's a picture of it with two of our kids up front, Lindsay Jane and Tabitha. If you didn't get a chance, we'll start doing this every year again, and you can get a picture with your family near it. And the question I had though is, do you think it looks pretty cool? Yeah, I do too. In fact, I would say it looks beautiful. Why do you think it looks so beautiful? What?
It looks like it's 3D.
Yeah, if you cross your eyes just right and look at it, it's like 3D. Yeah,
there's a lot of colors on it.
There's just a lot of color on it.
And a lot of pink.
A lot of pink. There's some blue, yellow, white. And it's an amazing cross to remind us of the life that we get from Jesus, the resurrected life through the cross. But here's the point I want to make today. All these flowers came from homes here. Everyone just brought them, and they put them on. And all of those flowers were beautiful in and of themselves. You know, they're probably in gardens or in someone's house, and they cut them. And if you looked at that flower, it would have had, you know, like five yellow flowers, just like the one flower that got cut off, and it very beautiful. But when they're brought to church, and they're all put on this one cross together, all of a sudden, the single flower becomes even more beautiful, just adding color and uniqueness and intricacy teamed up with all the other flowers. So when we look at it, we go, whoa, that's really cool. The flower by itself was cool, but when it gets together, it's amazing. Well, that's just a simple point I want to make, because we're going to talk about that in big church, is that when individuals come together, they bring a wonderful beauty when they're unified and they live life out together, a beauty that's sometimes not there when you're just kind of doing it by yourself. Paul, the guy who we'll be talking about, tells us that we should do everything we can to maintain a unity together. You know why? Because it's absolutely beautiful. It's stunning. It causes other people to turn and go, wow, that is amazing. And we hope that our lives, because of our love for Jesus, what brings us together, brings about that kind of reaction in the lives of others. Well, if you're going to stay in big church, we'll talk some more about it. Maybe you can talk about that in kids' church too. But let me pray for you. Lord, bless these kids and their uniqueness and beauty. Would you tie that all together that we would become even more beautiful in you, in your unity and oneness? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, see you later.
As they head to children's church, isn't it nice that, and just a beautiful thing that we are able to see young kids sitting like this, listening to the teaching of Scripture, and then have confirmation kids joining the church? What a wonderful experience that is. Similarly, our high school girls got together yesterday and spent all the day baking. And so after church today, the high school girls, our varsity girls, would like to invite you to the fellowship hall and eat their baked goods. So you see different generations of kids serving and being part of the church. So let us enjoy our fellowship together and continue to worship our Lord.
Like a foolish dreamer trying to build a highway to the sky, all my hopes, they come tumbling down, and I never knew just why, until today when you pulled away the clouds that hung like curtains from my eyes. I'd been blind all these wasted years, and I thought I was so wise. But then you took me by surprise. Like waking up from the longest dream, how real it seemed. Until your love broke through, I'd been lost in a fantasy that blinded. Until your love broke through. All my life I'd been searching for that crazy missing part, and with one touch you just rolled away the stone that held my heart. And now I see that the answer was as easy just asking you in. And now I'm so sure that I'll never doubt your gentle touch again. It's like the power of the wind. Oh, oh, oh. Like waking up from the longest dream, how real it seemed. Until your love in a fantasy that blinded me. Until your love broke through. Like waking up from the longest dream, how real it seems. Until your love broke
through. So thankful to have you with us, Nat. Thank you for that. That's I got to see his actual piano hands doing this. You couldn't see that, but boy, what a gift. And again, what a great week last, the whole Holy Week was. And, you know, shout out to our hospitality team for welcoming so many people, and to the children's workers doing special things for our kids, the administrative team putting together all of the bulletins and background and, you know, what we experienced, ministerial staff and what they did. Sandy for putting all the flowers together, Dan for changing the colors up here on the cross, and most of all, our music team, who in the midst of this transition, it just keeps blessing the socks off of this congregation, just encouraging us through their gift. And so thank you, choir, for singing, and musicians, instrumentalists, for what you did. And if Holy Week wasn't good enough, wasn't great enough, Laura and I actually got away for 2 days, Monday and Tuesday of Holy Week. Nikki said, no pastor goes away during Holy Week. But it was our 30th anniversary, and so we went to Blowing Rock to check out the couples retreat location. And if you're not going, you're going to miss an amazing time. Great place. I just can't wait to get up there. There are a few more slots available if you still want to sign up. Sign up this week, though, because we need to send the note in to say who's coming. But we're just going to have a great time, May 5th to the 7th, and hope you'll join us. Well, this morning we're going to return to Ephesians. We were studying Ephesians all fall. We came back to it in January, and now we're in chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. And this passage should sound familiar to you because we already studied it together. It was the very first passage we looked at when we turned to Ephesians. We didn't start in Ephesians 1. We started in Ephesians 4, these same verses. And I encouraged you that in that message, that do not take your eyes off of Ephesians 4, verses 1 to 6, because it's the most important passage in the entire letter that Paul writes. It's the transition between the first half and the second half of Ephesians, but it's actually his thesis statement of the entire epistle. So let's listen to it again as I read it. Here's what Paul writes to the Ephesians. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility, gentleness, with patience, bearing one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you. We cannot express how indebted we are for this written truth that you inspired Paul to write. And Lord, we're indebted because of your death and resurrection. We're indebted because of your grace and mercy. We're indebted because of the call you've given us. And so, Lord, we ask that what is written in these verses might be so, that we would live our lives out worthy of the calling we have received, as we've read in the first three chapters. And Lord, to that end, we ask you to bless our time of reflection now. In Jesus' name, amen. You've probably heard of the German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He wrote a number of books, among them two Christian classics that most people have heard of. One called The Cost of Discipleship, he wrote in 1937, and the second one that you may have heard of, Life Together, he wrote in 1939. He was arrested and thrown into jail by the SS in Nazi Germany in 1943 for participating in a plot to try to take Hitler out. And subsequently, he was hung for that opposition to the Third Reich. And in those last days in jail, he wrote a number of letters. And in one of his letters from prison, he wrote this. He said, "Good Friday and Easter free us up to think about other things far beyond our own personal fate, about the ultimate meaning of all life, suffering, and events." And then he says, "And we lay hold of a great hope," as he sat there all by himself in jail. And that's really Paul's primary point in this passage, as he wrote all of Ephesians. You remember the first half of the book, of this letter. I said that it's actually just one prayer. You know, he goes off this way and that way, but really it's just one long prayer from the beginning all the way to the end of chapter 3 and until he gets to the section where we're looking at. It's just one prayer. And in the middle, the heart of the prayer was this petition. We've mentioned it several times. I pray, this is Paul, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and listen, his incomprehensible great power for us who believe. That power is the same power as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand of the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every name that is invoked, not only in this present age, but into the age to come. You see, if we understand the resurrection power of Christ, the power that he gives us, the power that is ours, it frees us up to live a life that is radically different than what we see in this world. Bonhoeffer lived radically different than the culture that surrounded him. He lived, we live, by the resurrection power of Christ, a life that is based upon a rock-solid assurance of who we are, of what Christ has done in our lives, the extent he's gone to redeem us, the reality that he is raised to life, and that same power that raised him to life, it lives in us. The Holy Spirit is a part of us and promises the same things that Christ experienced before his death, after his death, as he sits on the throne above. It's all ours today. And so we're called to live in light of that, to not forget that, to depend on it, to lean into it. And so everything we read in the second half of Ephesians, starting out in verse 1 of this chapter, it's just all practical counsel on what it means to live in light of resurrection-empowered, spirit-filled life. In the first half of Ephesians, you only find one command, one verbal imperative where Paul says, oh, you should do this. When you get to the second half of Ephesians, you get 40 imperatives, 40 exhortations to say, ah, now that you understand all this, here's the way in which you should live your life out. We're supposed to take to heart all that we learned of the glory of God, the grace of God, the plan of the Father, the work of the Son on our behalf, the presence of the Spirit that Paul talks about in the first half of Ephesians, this resurrection power that is ours because of the work of Christ and the Spirit's presence. And so where does he start? What's the very first thing when he begins to get practical and say, okay, here's what life is like? The first thing Paul tells us about a Spirit-filled life is that it's a life that you do not live alone. There's no Lone Ranger Christians. You don't live alone. You live together in community, with humility and gentleness and love. It's a life of oneness with each other that we live out. In the second book that I mentioned of Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the one called Life Together, it's all about this theme. And he starts out his book with the same way we started out this service. He quotes Psalm 133. He says, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when God's people dwell together in unity." He starts it off that way, but immediately he goes on another track. He begins to talk about how Jesus hung on the cross all alone, how he was surrounded by enemies, mocking him, making fun of him, how he was abandoned by all his friends. And there he was, just all alone on the cross, dying. He goes on to say, those who follow Christ take up their cross, and they're going to suffer in the same way. People are going to make fun of them. They're going to be mocked. They're going to suffer. And often it's going to happen all alone. They'll be ostracized. They'll be considered enemies by this world. They'll be hated by this world, Bonhoeffer says. And even more, it's not just that the enemy is coming this way. We're supposed to march right out into the world, to the farthest nation where Christ has never been known, and make him known. We're scattered abroad, often all by ourselves. You've felt it at times at work, haven't you? Or at school, where you feel like no one understands me as a person of faith. It feels lonely. And then just Bonhoeffer stops at that point in his book, and he takes stock of the gift of friendship for us as Christians, that we have each other. He says, between the death of Christ and the last day, it is only by gracious anticipation of the last things that Christians are privileged to live in invisible fellowship with other Christians. In other words, the things in the future we haven't seen yet, we get to experience them right now. And then he says, it is by the grace of God that a congregation is permitted to gather visibly in this world to share God's word and sacrament. Not only do we get to experience the things that are in the future now, we actually get to experience now with each other. We get to live out this life together. And then he says, not all Christians receive this blessing. The imprisoned, the sick,
The scattered, lonely, the proclaimers of the gospel in foreign lands stand alone. They know that visible fellowship is a blessing. Well, 4 years later, after writing this, just as Bonhoeffer expected, he was arrested and he sat alone in a Nazi jail cell. He experienced what he had written about. And surely you can picture him in that jail cell, remembering how blessed he was to sit in a pew like this with brothers and sisters who dearly loved him, who loved the Lord, who lived their lives out together. And how different it is when you're all alone in jail. And just from that perspective, you know, it gives us a little insight into what Paul writes here. Paul calls himself in verse 1, he says, I urge you as a prisoner of the Lord. Paul is a prisoner just like Bonhoeffer was a prisoner. Paul says, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you received. Paul was under house arrest. He couldn't go where he wanted to go. Some could come in and see him, but he had a Roman guard watching him all the time in the same house. He couldn't leave this place. He would have loved to walk out and be with his friends in Ephesus again. He had been with them before. They had cried tears as he parted from them. He loved them, and he couldn't be there. I, Paul, remember. Don't take this for granted. Live a life worthy of the call that you have received. This wasn't, his counsel wasn't just coming out of the theology of the past three chapters. It was, but it was also coming out of personal experience, personal appreciation of this gift. Just as Bonhoeffer wrote, to live life out, to rejoice with, to mourn with, to encourage one another in the midst of hardship and suffering until the advent of Christ's return. Life together. Jeff just shared it up here. The kids. Life together. Life in unity. This is an immeasurable gift we have. The writer of the letter of Hebrews writes it this way. He says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful, and let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meetings together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, all the more as you see the day approaching. As you look around at each other today, I want you to, whether you're doing it right now, you're all looking at me, it's fine. But, take some time. If you didn't get tired of listening to me, just look around at each other. And just think, oh, God, thank you. Thank you for this child. Thank you for this old person. Thank you for this person from Africa. Thank you for this person. No, you don't have to, elbow each other because you love, old people there. No, just be appreciating what a great diversity and a gift that God has given us. That's why we go on retreats together, because it's fun, because it builds friendships. That's why the youth, when I was in with the youth in their confirmation class, they came to the session and I said, what has encouraged you in your walk with Christ? And they mentioned their parents. Why? Because of the relationship. They mentioned their friendships, how important their friendships were.
life together is meaningful. It's precious. Don't take it for granted. We were at 506 Tudor Place on Saturday, just cleaning mud and picking up bricks and, you know, having a good time. What a gift. Well, Paul tells us three things about this unity in these six verses. He tells us that unity is a work of the Spirit. It's a God-made thing, not a man-made thing. Verse 3, you can see it there. He says, make every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit. This bond that we have isn't just something we make up, that we try to bring about ourselves. It's actually a gift and a creation that God infuses into our lives himself. I've been a children's pastor, youth pastor, teaching adult classes, preaching, wherever I am, I've always valued the theological importance of unity and taught about it. I've taught from Ephesians chapter 4. I've taught from 1 Corinthians 12 and 13, John 17, 1 John 4. But I've always been frustrated that in the Old Testament, you can hardly find any discussion about unity. The language of oneness and unity, it's just not there like it is in the New. You turn the New Testament, every time you turn a page, it's talking about oneness and union and relationship. You turn to the Old Testament, well, yeah, there's the psalm that we just looked at, Psalm 133, a couple verses there. We hear in Exodus that God says, you know, the Lord, your God is one. You know, so there's a language of one. Jeff preached on a passage, Ezekiel, a prophetic passage, that, you know, a few verses about how Judah and Israel will be brought together again. You can hardly find, that's just a few small verses. There's a proverb that says, you know, three strands wound together is stronger than one that is by itself. That's it. 39 books and four, I would say, meager statements about unity and oneness. And so I always friend, why is that? I don't get that. Why isn't it all throughout the Old Testament? And finally, in one of, you know, we encourage you to be an intentional community. Have a group of people that you're living life out with. My intentional community is a staff. And we get together and we study scripture together, we pray. And at this one time, we're looking at Ephesians in the fall. And I finally understand why there's no discussion of unity or very little discussion of unity and oneness in the Old Testament. And it's all because of what we talked about a little bit in January. It all has to do with the expectation that in the Old Testament, anticipation that the egregious sin of the Tower of Babel would finally be overcome at some point. It all has to do with that. That's why there's no discussion. Remember what happened in the Tower of Babel. It says, come, let us build ourselves a city, a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which they had made. And the Lord said, behold, listen, they are one people. They all have one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. And so the Lord comes down. He confuses their language. He scatters them so they won't be one anymore. Why? Because of what they would have become if He allowed what was unfolding to continue to unfold. This was mankind's attempt to be one and unified that would have ended up just like Genesis 6, where it says, the Lord saw the wickedness of man great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart were only evil continually. So imagine all of humanity as a juggernaut of evil as one together. And God said, no way. He separated them and said, that is not happening ever again. It's not, they're not going to come together again until God himself establishes a unity. God himself would bring about a oneness until the heart of mankind could be changed and would be changed. And then all the people around the world would come back together again in a wholly different way. One that wasn't promoting pride and arrogance and power, but one based on humility, an acknowledgement of God for who he is and who we are, based in love. And so, believe me when I say this, that there will be no unity in this world without Jesus Christ. There will be no oneness until Jesus is at the center of it. The United Nations will not bring it about. Bumper stickers with all of the religious symbols tied together to spell out the word coexist is not going to bring it about. A new world order is not going to bring about oneness in unity in the world. The only power which has the ability to bring about authentic unity, authentic oneness, is the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the work of his Spirit. And so you do not hear anything about unity in oneness from the Tower of Babel on, until Jesus begins to speak about it on the last night of his crucifixion, until he predicts that when I die, the Holy Spirit will come and men's hearts, people's hearts will be changed. And they will actually love one another. The kind of love that should have been there way back when will now be in their hearts. They'll live this out. And you do not see this unity from that point on until the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2 is poured out. And then all of a sudden, Luke is saying, throughout the book of Acts, they were one in heart and mind. And who were they? They were people from all nations, all tribes. Look, I'm not saying the culture doesn't want this. We talk about unity, and there's cultural forces that today are they're waving the flag of unity. But if you pull back the thin veneer of that unity that's being advocated in this age, you're going to find a reality that's no different than Babel. It's driven by a desire to exalt the self, to make us more powerful, to be the arbitrators of value and morality. We get to do whatever we want. And in the midst of that false flag, those same powers begin to create a uniformity, a controlled unanimity, that doesn't allow any kind of different views to be held by anyone. In fact, if someone holds a different view, they're canceled. You don't belong. Get out. very different, isn't it, from the kind of unity that Paul speaks about. Paul's unity, the Spirit's unity, is radically different than the world. What does it look like, Paul says in verses 1 and 2? Live a life worthy of the calling you've received with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love. You see, Spirit-produced unity is the fruit of love. Love is the fruit of humility. A humility towards God, a humility towards one another. The unity of Babel was one of pride, a desire to cast God aside, make a name for yourself, and the powerful and the prestige and those in control would determine whether you'd live or you'd die, just like Adolf Hitler. That's not biblical unity. That's not spirit created unity. It's not Christ-centered unity. Our relationships are characterized by kindness, by gentleness, an openness to listen to each other, to think through things together, not to shoot each other as soon as they say something that's different than you. We're walking life out together, and we think more highly of the person over there than we think of ourselves. We don't look to our own interests. We look at the interests of others. This is what humility is. And if you're in a relationship right now, husband and wife, and you're having a hard time, humble yourself. Consider your spouse better than yourself, smarter than yourself. Look to their interests, and not just marriage, but in the church. You have an issue with somebody here? Well, consider them better than yourself. Allow them to have their way instead of your way. And all of a sudden, this crazy thing called love pops up. And there's a bond of peace that wasn't there before. And that allows our life together to be radically different than the world. That allows the fact that those of you who are here who voted for Joe Biden are sitting right next to those of you who are here who voted for Donald Trump. And you actually like each other. Or even worse, those of you who like Duke and those of you who like UNC actually eat at the same dinner table together. It's unfathomable how that can happen. It's why we sing songs on the piano and the organ and guitars. It's because we love each other. And we know some people here like that, and some people here like that. And we're not driven by our own pride, what we like. We're driven by our relationship with each other. We want to be a church who serves each other. And so if you like classical and you like contemporary, then you want classical because you love him and you want what they love here. And you want, you know what I mean? That's the kind of life that we live out together. Well, anyway, that's what allows every socioeconomic reality. You know, rich people, they don't like to hang out with poor people. Poor people don't like to hang out with rich people if you actually ask them. But Christian poor people and Christian rich people love each other. And tell you the truth, old people don't like to hang out with young people. And young people, they don't really like to hang out with old people. They like to hang out with people just like themselves, except here. Because they really love each other. They want to be around each other. One last thing. The oneness, the unity that we have in Christ is different than that of the world. And Paul points out that it is in this relationship with each other that we actually experience God. There's no other way. This is it. Among each other, together. That's what, he says this. He says, there's one body, one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to you, your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father over all, who is over all and through all and in all. And when you hear those one faith, one body, one baptism, you kind of picture them by themselves. Okay, there's one faith. Ah, oh, what a unique faith. No other faith is like it. There's this one. And there's one body. Oh, the body of Christ. It's different than any other thing out there. And you got this one. And one Lord, you know, Jesus. He's a unique Savior. No one like him. And one, that's not what Paul's saying. Don't think of these things individually as just unique. They are unique. They are individual. But his point is that they're all a package. When you have faith, when you are baptized, when you're brought together, you're with God. You experience the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. First John 4:12 says, "No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us." We're not going to see God on this side with our eyes, but we will experience him in a very real and tangible way through each other and through the love that we have. Last story. So years back, I took a mission trip to the Dominican Republic, Santo Domingo, the capital city, with a group of youth. We had a couple free hours in the afternoon, and we noticed a mall. And we're like, wonder what a mall in the Dominican Republic would be like. So we pulled off, we went into the mall, and guess what? It looked just like our malls. No different. Two levels, stores, except for one thing. No one was there. I mean, that's sort of what malls are like now. But back then, no one, you know, you go in the mall here, all the people buying, went in this mall, no one was there. It was weird. And so we didn't know what to do with ourselves. We walked a little bit this way, a little bit that way, and then a couple kids decided to get some ice cream over there, and there were actually pay phones. We didn't have cell phones. This was like 90s or something. No cell phones. And a couple of kids said, could we call home to see if we can actually call home from the? Sure, go ahead. Give it a crack. So they called home, a couple, you know, two different ones. And then there were two boys who saw the escalators. And they looked around, and there was no one in this mall. Like, they wanted to do what they never were able to do in their lives. They decided to run up the escalator, the down escalator. They wanted to run up to the top of it. If you're ever in the Dominican Republic, in a mall alone, do not run up the down escalator. It's not because they were injured. It's because when they got to the top of that escalator, there was this giant hulking security guard who had a machine gun hanging off of his side, looking very unhappy. with our boys. So I took the right escalator up and intervened and began to, you know, and they didn't understand anything he said because it was Spanish, and neither did I, hardly, but I smiled and we started to take the escalator back down. And then we noticed by the telephone there were now two or three kids there. And by the time we got to the bottom, the rest of the entire group were circled around the telephone. And when we got over to the group, I quickly realized Stephen Powell, who was one of the ones who called home, found out that his grandmother died unexpectedly. And he began to cry, just crying, right in the middle of this mall, because he loved his grandmom. And there we were, Stephen crying in the middle, all of the kids around him, and we just hugged each other. And we prayed for God's comfort. We sang a song. And I have no idea what that security guard was thinking at that moment. But I know we met Jesus there. In that moment of sorrow, we experienced God. Behold how good and pleasant it is when God's people dwell together in unity. You know why? Because God's there. God is there. It's through his presence. It's through the radical diversity which is among us. Because of the radical humility and kindness and gentleness and patience and love which has fostered it, that's how the world's going to see who Jesus is. Jesus prayed the night before his crucifixion, "May they be one, Father, as we are one. May they be brought to complete unity, that the world might know you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." So that the world might know who Jesus is, may they be one. Paul says, be eager, do everything you can to maintain the unity of the Spirit. Wouldn't it be great if we were the answer to Jesus' prayer? Let's pray. Lord, we do ask for that kind of unity and that kind of oneness, one that's based on humility and kindness and gentleness and patience with each other. Lord, help us to think better of others than ourselves. Help us to not insist on our own way, but bless others by allowing them to have theirs. And Lord, in the midst of it, we pray that you would be glorified, that they might know that we are your disciples by our love, that your name is lifted above all names instead of our name. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Let me invite you all to stand and sing a song that I think illustrates a lot of what Pastor Chris was just saying and a lot of what Paul is saying in these passages, that we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, and they will know that we belong to Christ. They will know we are Christians by our love. Let's sing this together.
We are one in the Spirit. dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Yes, they'll know who we are. Yes, they'll know us by our love. As we serve, as we worship, as we build the kingdom up, suing justice and loving mercy, and walking with God humbly, His body we would be, but it's Jesus they would see. Sing all praise to the Father.
All praise to the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Please be seated. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that you love us first. And in our response to your love for us, we may love you and love each other because you are love. Lord, we confess that oftentimes we do not seek you first. We do not seek love first. But thank you, Lord, for the gift of Easter, that we may celebrate every day you are love and grace. Lord, we thank you for our church, that we may gather together knowing that we are called to love one another, and to share the love that we've experienced from you, to share the grace that we've experienced to the communities around this church that need to hear. And Lord, we know that there are people even in this congregation that are watching online, that are not able to watch online, who are going through difficult times. We pray, Lord, that you would be present with those who have doubts, questions, who are suffering, have illnesses, concerns about finances, concerns about loved ones. Remind us, Lord, that you are near, that you did rise on the third day just as you said that you would. You are faithful and true. Lord, help us to know that the good news is for us today, and that you're working throughout the world in other churches, in other lands, so that we, the church, may know that we are one in you. So, Lord, we gather with hope, with thanksgiving in who you are and how you knit us together with you and with one another. So, Lord, we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue to worship our Lord. Please stand if you're able, singing the church's One Foundation.
one foundation is Jesus Christ, your Lord. She is His new creation by water and the Word. From heaven He came and sought her to be His holy bride. And with His own blood He bought her, and for her life He died. Elect from every nation, yet one or all the earth, her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth, one holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every grace sins due. Mid toil and tribulation, with God the three in one, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore.
You take the opportunity to join us in Fellowship Hall to greet our new members of our church and give them a hug and word of encouragement. And if for any reason you're here and you have a prayer that's upon your heart and you want to be surrounded by others who love you and pray with you about the burden that might be that you may be carrying alone, come up front. Jeff will be here. Other folks will be here, and they'd consider it a great privilege to pray with you about anything that may be upon your heart this day. Now receive the benediction. To the one who, by his blood, has made us one, who, by his spirit, binds us together in peace and gives us a calling that we are called to live out in a worthy manner, with all humility, gentleness, and peace and patience with each other. To the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be all glory, majesty, and dominion now and forevermore. Go in his peace. Amen.